Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace, the all-in-one website building platform to help you run your business.
That one right there made me the greatest player of all time.
Made me the greatest player of all time. Greatest player of all time.
Michael Jordan's been widely known as the greatest basketball player of all time for really the last 30 years. And no one has ever come as close to challenging that title in the eyes of fans and media more than LeBron James. And while LeBron has made a great case for the argument and believes he's the best player ever, we'll look at both sides, but also the real reasons as to why LeBron James will never and can never be the GOAT. And let's start things off by understanding the fact that MJ played in a league that was in favor of big men, and with things like hand checking and players having the ability to be much more aggressive and play a lot rougher than they do now. And then almost right after he left the league, both of those things changed. And the game has evolved into a much faster paced style built for perimeter players to exceed, which is why we've seen a lot less traditional big men in the game today. But with that being said, let's look at some of the most common basic arguments that are made with the fact that LeBron is bigger, stronger, faster, a better rebounder, and a better passer than Michael Jordan. And all of those things are definitely true, but that's also the same exact argument you can make towards a guy like Russell Westbrook being better than Steph Curry. I mean, Russ averages a triple-double, he's much faster, stronger, and a better athlete, but we all know that Steph is the better player. So right off the bat, those things can build onto James' case, but they don't make or break an argument. But with that being said, LeBron may have the better overall game, but MJ's a far better scorer and defender than James ever was, which will lead us into looking at both of these guys' careers in the regular season. Jordan was a 10-time scoring champion, a 9-time member of the All-Defensive First Team, and a 3-time steals leader. And he had one of the most underrated feats in NBA history, winning the Defensive Player of the Year award and a scoring title in the same season, which only himself and David Robinson have ever done. And if you compare this to LeBron James, who's only won one scoring title, 5 All-Defensive First Teams, and never led the league in steals. And while we're here, let's not forget to mention the fact that MJ has the highest career points per game average, with 30.1 for his entire career, while LeBron's still sitting at 27.2 points a game. And even though James has been the more efficient scorer, and Jordan's been the better overall scorer, scoring efficiently means nothing unless it equates to more wins, which it hasn't. And on top of all this is ignoring the fact that, like I mentioned earlier, the rules now are built for offensive players to thrive and for players to get fouls for passing gas. So even with all of that, these numbers are still skewed heavily in LeBron's favor. And then on the defensive end, we will give it up to LeBron for his ability to guard more positions than Jordan, but even with that, he's still thought of as a far worse defender. So with all the rebounding, assists, defense, steals, and points scored, it led to LeBron winning 4 MVPs compared to the 5 that Jordan's won. With all that being said, within the time they played, it's clear that Jordan's been much more dominant in the regular season. And then you have people that say that one of the reasons LeBron is the greatest of all time is because of the effect that he has on his team. And the fact that when he left Cleveland both times and the Heat, they were a much worse team the season after. While when Jordan retired, his team still nearly made the NBA Finals. Now this is something that people hear and they go look it up and it turns out to be true, so they believe it. But they ignore the fact of how much LeBron's teams were constructed just for him. Because if LeGMs wanted a player, he's gotten him. I mean, in his first run in Cleveland, they were one of the top teams in the league, and once he left, they became one of the worst until he came back. But I mean, when the centerpiece of your franchise leaves with zero notice, they're obviously gonna turn out to be terrible. And then he goes to the Heat and does his thing, and when he leaves, they win 17 less games, even with Wade and Bosh still on the roster. But let's not forget how they assembled their roster within that time. They got nearly every available stretch four they could find, and as many solid centers and perimeter shooters that they could find, to stick out on the three-point lines to stretch the floor, with guys like Rashard Lewis, Ray Allen, Shane Battier, James Jones, and Mike Miller. And when mostly all of those guys left the same season that LeBron did, the next year the Heat had a much different roster, which would obviously make the team play worse. And then most recently he left the Cavs, and they went from the NBA Finals to one of the worst teams in the league this season. But again, let's not forget how they lost Kyrie and didn't get much in return, and then traded half their roster halfway through the season to try and find players that fit better with LeBron. So again, when you completely fit your roster around one guy, and then he leaves, it's not surprising for them to do terrible afterwards. And he did bring that team to the finals, so we do gotta give him credit. But it seems like he's a lot better at making bad teams great, and Jordan was better at making his great team a championship team. So one of the reasons the Bulls were still so good after Jordan left was because Pippen was in his prime and playing like an MVP, and because the team wasn't built for only Jordan to succeed. But now that we've brought up talk of the NBA Finals, let's look at both of these guys' finals appearances. Michael Jordan is 6-0 in the NBA Finals. Himself and Scottie Pippen led the Bulls to beating Magic Johnson and the Lakers, Clyde Drexler in the Blazers, the Charles Barkley-led Suns, Gary Payton, Sean Kemp in the Supersonics, and the Karl Malone and John Stockton Utah Jazz twice. And people say that he couldn't win without Scottie Pippen, which he couldn't have. But on the other hand, we have LeBron James, who had to team up with Chris Bosh and Dwayne Wade before he could win one. He did make the finals on that original Cavs team, but got swept by the Spurs. So again, he deserves credit for that. But then he would join the Heat, and with two other superstars get beat by the 2011 Dallas Mavericks. And not only that, LeBron James completely collapsed under the pressure and was outscored in the NBA Finals by Jason Terry, who came off the bench for the entire series. And then he would come back and beat the Westbrook, Harden, Durant Thunder the next year, and then the San Antonio Spurs, before losing to them in the finals rematch, where the Spurs outscored the Heat by the largest average point differential in NBA Finals history. After that, he would move to Cleveland and be paired up with two more younger superstars in Kyrie Irving and Kevin Love, where they would lose to the Warriors the first year, beat the 73-9 Warriors, and then lose to them the past two seasons after they added Kevin Durant, giving LeBron James a 3-6 NBA Finals record. Jordan beat every single finals opponent he had so definitively, he wouldn't even let it be taken to 7 games. And for there to try to be an argument for a player that's lost just as many finals as MJ's won truly doesn't make any sense. For a player that's cracked under the pressure as many times as LeBron has, it's hurt his legacy far too much for him to truly be the GOAT. He's had opportunities in these defining moments of his career, and he just hasn't shown up too many times. I mean, you can't look at Jordan's legacy and really point out very many, if any, real negatives. But that's just not the case with LeBron James. Now, the record alone should be enough to settle the argument, but since it isn't for a lot of LeBron fans, let's look at it this way. I mean, there's no way that Jordan would have ever lost to those Dallas Mavericks, or let anyone outplay him the way they did. Or let the San Antonio Spurs beat him in 5 games by an average of 14 points in the finals. And LeBron definitely could have won that first championship against the Warriors, but we can't discredit him too much, because he did win in the second series when they went 73-9, and then these last two we honestly can't put them against him because of the whole snake situation. But I mean, we can't feel too bad for him either, because he's the one who started the whole super team scenario. But that'll lead us to our next point, which is the clutch factor, and both of these guys' desire and ability to close out games. Now there's no denying the fact that the Heat would have lost the first series against the Spurs without Ray Allen. LeBron shot and missed the game-tying shot before Ray Allen knocked it down himself. When all the pressure was on him to save the NBA championship, he failed. And it's not like this was just another big shot in the finals, because the Spurs were 10 seconds away from winning their 4th game and becoming NBA champions unless he made that shot, and he didn't. And he only has that championship because Ray Allen knocked it down. And then we fast forward to his next title, when they beat the 73-9 Warriors. And what LeBron recently said made him believe that he's the greatest player of all time. But I mean, when Game 7 was tied with a minute left, LeBron's not the one who hit the go-ahead shot. He did get that block, but Kyrie Irving made the shot, who by the way averaged 27 points a game in that series. Now James did play great, but I don't know how that could have made him feel like the GOAT. Either way, let's be honest, if it were LeBron who hit both of those shots instead, this greatest of all time discussion would be a lot closer. But then to have straight up given up halfway through this past year's NBA Finals and gotten swept hurts his personal case a ton. I mean, LeBron's never had the same level of a winning mentality that Jordan had. He didn't have much of it at all when he first came into the league, but it's something he's developed throughout his entire career. But I mean, Jordan's always had it even before he was in the league when he hit the game-winning shot at North Carolina to start his career. And he's had other playoff moments like the flu game, the game winner on Craig Elo, and the greatest shot of all time that closed out the Jazz, Jordan's career, and his 6th NBA championship. So now by this point, it should be clear who the greatest player of all time is. But one last thing we do have to mention and give credit to that can't be ignored from this argument is LeBron and his longevity. I mean, MJ went to college and retired for the first time at his peak, and for the second time when he still had a couple good years left in him, which gave his main run on the Bulls a span of 13 years. While on the other hand, James is in the middle of his 16th right now, and still playing at an extremely high level, and hasn't shown too many signs of slowing down. But this longevity has led to LeBron passing Michael Jordan in nearly every statistical playoff and regular season category there is, because he's played a lot more games. And when it's all said and done, James has a huge chance to be the league's all-time leading scorer. So his longevity does hold some value, but to be honest, I don't care if he plays for 25 years. If he can't do in 25 years what Jordan did in 13, that's even more of a reason why he shouldn't be the GOAT. We can go ahead and say LeBron is the second greatest player ever. I mean, I don't think he has any more MVPs in him, and he may be able to pull together a championship, maybe two, but even then, that's not on MJ's level. We can go ahead and say that LeBron is the second greatest player ever, but at the height of Michael Jordan's game, he had a much higher peak at his best years than LeBron's ever had. And while LeBron's peak years have been longer, he's never exactly reached that MJ level. And like I said, when more superstars come to LA, that might bring them a championship or two, but to be honest, I feel LeBron's already lost his opportunity to become the greatest of all time. Because when you look through all of this that's been laid out, there's just too many negatives already on LeBron's side for him to be thought of as a better player than Michael Jordan. By his disappearance in big moments, leading to him needing to be saved in the finals, or just flat out losing, his inferior defense and scoring, and his amount of career achievements. He's a great player, and he has a ton of positives on his side, but when you're comparing him to a player that has few to no negatives about his entire career, there's not a true argument. And I think that's all that needs to be said. But you know, while we're on the topic of the greatest of all time, I got one last all-time great to mention, and that's Squarespace. Now, if you're looking to start up a new business in the new year, then this is where you start. Because every great business has a great website, and Squarespace makes website design simple by having all the tools you could ever need in one place with their all-in-one platform. And if any of this process gets too tricky, they have award-winning customer service to help you through every step of the way. So head over to Squarespace for a free trial, and when you are ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/AustinSweat with two T's to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. So make sure to check them out, make sure to subscribe if you haven't already, don't forget to drop a like, comment on who you think is the real GOAT, and I'll catch you next video.